Well, if you don't know what time it is, I'm about to tell you. If I can get my life together enough to stick to the schedule I've set for myself and edit this on time, today is the 10-year anniversary of Parallax 2. I wonder. I either regret or am happy to inform you, depending on what type of viewer of this channel you are, that I will be dedicating this month to videos about this album, which is certainly in the top three and maybe top one of albums I've spent the most time with in my life. I did a video about Layer Ghost Arrest very early in my YouTube career, a whole 2 years ago, but I have so much to say about this album that I'm starting Parallax 2 month with another video about a completely different aspect of this song. But first, a detour with some background. So there's this thing called sonata form, which is a set of conventions for shaping a piece of music that were all the rage in the classical and romantic eras. Let's go through the basic roadmap of this type of form using one of the most famous of these, the first movement of Mozart's 40th symphony. Sonata form pieces will generally start right off the bat with a theme called the primary or first theme. Then you get a transition, which will generally drive to what's called a medial caesura, which is like a pause in the action. Then you get a second contrasting theme, which will generally be in the key of the dominant. So in a different key from the first one, a fifth up from the tonic, which is where we started. And this closes the exposition. Then we get the development section, where stuff gets a lot less stable, and often the two themes duke it out, all leading to what is called the dominant lock, or standing on the dominant. A big dominant chord that then leads back to the start of the recapitulation where we get both themes again, but, and this is kind of the important main thing, with the second theme now in the key of the tonic instead of the dominant. There are a lot of other details, and there are all sorts of variations on this basic shape, but this will be enough to get us started. Because in this video, and you might want to sit down for this, I'm going to argue that Layer Ghost to Rest, the third track on Parallax 2, is a progressive metal sonata form. Wandering on. song starts with a bunch of stuff that I'm going to call introductory material before we get to the first theme. I talked about the expanding return nature of this section in that older riff analysis video, and I'll mention it a little bit more in some of the other videos I do this month. But one thing I'll draw attention to here about this intro section is that we have basically three types of material. There are the chugs. There are these fretboard shifted guitar shapes outlining these chords. And then there's this constant motion tonal harmony counterpoint section. I mean, let's just stop to appreciate this riff. Between the Bear and Me's music is full of these little, like, throwaway riffs that are so intricate and cool, and it's just such a great fingering and positioning exercise on guitar that dusting it off reminds me that I owe, like, 80% of whatever guitar chops I still have to obsessively learning BT Bam songs for the first 5 years I was playing guitar. But for the purpose of my argument in this video, this juxtaposition of three different types of harmonic organization in the introduction is what's relevant. There's rhythmic stuff that just introduces the tonic, there's fretboard-based stuff that is clearly based on these finger shapes, but makes a little less sense in terms of tonal harmony, and then there's really in-the-box harmonic stuff in F-sharp minor that drives towards specific types of tonal resolution. Keep this juxtaposition in mind, because I'm going to expand on it when I return to it near the end of this video. But anyway, after the introduction, we get the first theme, which sounds like this. This theme has a lot of typical characteristic of first themes in sonata forms. It's angular, it's harmonically unambiguous, and as an added bonus, it's got this cool, rhythmically fragmented counterpoint that I think points in general towards the classical origins of sonata forms. So you hear this counterpoint and you think, oh, that sounds like Bach, and that kind of puts you in the general ballpark of hearing a sonata form. Then we get a little transition with a break in the texture leading to a 5 of 5 chord, which is a textbook medial caesura. Then we get the second theme, which typically for second themes is more flowing and legato, especially when the guitar solo version of it comes in. And it definitely seems to be in the key of the dominant, or C sharp major, which is the first chord of this section. Applaud me for playing the guitar solo version of this theme, which involved bringing my left hand up to a speed that I haven't needed in a long time, except when I originally wrote this script that was true, but then I did that video about Anomalous and the Dream Theater thing and all these other ones that were actually really left hand intensive, so I guess it's more of the same of that. But this solo is really, it's some slightly different stuff. And it's really a beautiful fretboard workout. Even just like, if you didn't know how it sounded, just like how it makes your hand move and how it makes you practice all these different position shifts and different picking patterns and all that. So I highly recommend learning it if you're looking for something, some fun, like full fretboard legato, sweeping, tapping practice. Transition out of this second theme and into the development section. I talked about how some of this development section is organized in my other video about this song, so I won't dwell on that. Basically, there's one motive that gets transformed into a bunch of different versions, and there are a whole lot of nested expanding returns. But for this video, I want to focus on how things get increasingly fragmented and chaotic, leading up to a dramatic simplification where they just hammer on this dominant prolongation by way of a chromatic upper neighbor. So C sharp, D, C sharp, D, for a really long time. This is a quintessential and very belligerent version of the standing on the dominant that typically closes the development section of sonata forms. Weak souls, weak minds, weak life, if you haven't heard. Then, as you'd expect, we head back to the first theme again to start the recapitulation. So far, things have been pretty easy to put into sonata theory terms. Here's where things start to get a little trickier and a little more interesting theory-wise, starting with this recapitulation of the first theme, because it's the same theme, but the meter is different. Instead of being mostly in 2-4 with a turnaround, it's now in mostly 3-4 with a turnaround. The notes are all the same in the guitars, but their rhythms are different, the spacing is different, and the vocal line is different too. This is one of many very cool rhythmic transformations that BT BAM does, where they stretch or compress a melodic idea to fit an entirely new metric or rhythmic or tempo context. Then we get a longer transitional thing, which brings back some of the 7-4 of the intro, and actually brings back the exact bass riff from the second part of the chugs in the intro. We get the second theme, which, if you know your sonata theory or remember from the beginning of the video, should be transposed into the tonic. Except it's not, because it's the same notes, everything is exactly the same as before. We'll be right back. I think I can theory my way out of this. The cool thing, if you're willing to indulge me even further in this already pretty deep and niche video, is that the chords for the second theme were always a little ambiguous. In the exposition, I gave one way of analyzing them, which puts it all in C sharp major. Actually, another way of analyzing them, according to which it's in F sharp major, if you change a couple of assumptions. Basically, it comes down to the difference between classical tonal harmony and rock tonal harmony. In classical harmony, 5-to-1 motion is the most important thing. According to this, this section starts on 1, or C sharp major, and ends on 5, or G sharp 7, which loops back around to the start. This was why it was easy to say that C sharp was the tonic the first time that we heard it. But in rock harmony, things are a little less strict. 5-to-1 can mean closure, but there are a few other formulas that mean closure, like, equally strongly. One is 4-to-1. And another is 6-7-1, the so-called Aeolian progression. And what do you know, but we get both of these types of closure pointing to F sharp minor instead of C sharp minor in the second theme. So what I'm saying is that maybe if we hear the recapitulation version of the second theme according to rock harmony, it feels like something that starts on the dominant, resolves to the tonic in the middle twice, then drifts back to 5 of 5 and the dominant to start the cycle again. In other words, if we hear this with classical harmony, it sounds more like it's in C sharp major, but if we hear it in rock harmony, it's possible to hear it as being centered on F sharp minor. Maybe a little bit of a stretch, and if you want to see more of the gory harmonic analysis details that got into this, I should mention that I wrote my master's thesis on Parallax 2, and I invite you to check that out. But I'm going to say that we've saved the sonata form analysis of this piece for the purposes of this video. I, for one, am extremely relieved. Phew. Except maybe this makes us rethink what this sonata form is doing in this piece in the first place, actually. In traditional sonata forms, things are often framed as a conflict between two keys, but here there is kind of enough of that to fill out the basic sonata form, but I think that the harmonic battle, if there must be one, why can't all these chords just be friends, is more between different types of harmonic organization rather than different key centers. Remember when I was talking about the intro, how I brought up the three different types of material? The rhythmic stuff on the tonic, the fretboard shifting stuff, and the contrapuntal tonal stuff? Remember? Well, it's kind of like the song is about the negotiation of these different ways of picking notes. The intro mixes these pretty freely, the development has a drift from tonal harmony to modular, guitar-based, and symmetric harmony before landing on the dominant to return to the recapitulation, and the second theme in the recapitulation relies on a rock harmony hearing to make the sonata form make sense. And let's expand our brains one more time. It certainly does appear like we can hear this as a conflict or alternation between a couple different types of organizing harmonic systems. But really, the different ways of organizing are completely codependent in this song, as they are in pretty much all of B.T. Bam's music. it's not just that there's a lot of tonal stuff and a lot of modular stuff and all sorts of other types of stuff all mixed together, but that all these different systems actually prop each other up. And if you try to separate them, you realize that they're all kind of like filling each other in. So like, to return to that example from here, you need the rock harmonic system to save the classical sonata form understanding. Okay, that's pretty abstract, and I'm not sure my summary of these ideas really makes sense in this video. So again, you can check out my master's thesis for a little more nuanced explanation of all of these entanglements. Here's a full playthrough of this because you deserve a little treat. We'll be right back. finish by anticipating a very common question. Did the band write a sonata form on purpose? Well, I'd love to know the answer to this, and I don't think it's out of the question. I mean, Dan at least has mentioned being pretty deep into traditional theory. I don't think the answer will change this analysis. I've brought this idea up in a few other places in my videos, but I'm never trying to prove intent or anything old-fashioned like that. All I'm trying to do with these videos is make stuff more interesting and fun to listen to, and maybe point out things you may not have noticed, and link things to some larger patterns, and maybe give ideas for a composition, if you're trying to write this type of music. Hearing the resonances with sonata form in this song has certainly done that for me, and I hope it does the same for you. So yeah, Between the Buried and Me's music is very much in that sweet spot for me where it's just a blast to listen to, but also a lot of fun to dig deeper into and think about, and I hope you agree enough to stick around for the next few videos about this enormous album. See ya.